Cybersecurity at the workshop in 12 minutes. I'll start with it's wartime and no one notices it, the threats. Then I'll focus on to why we are collecting so much data and why that data is so much exposed if you start using it on the internet. Then I'll focus more on how can you protect or actually isolate your production equipment from these kinds of threats. And I'll give some practical advices or hints. My name is Egbert-Jan Sol. I work at TNO, assigned to the Smart Industry Program Bureau, and where we have made a workshop on cybersecurity on the work, on the shop floor, which you can actually watch if you go to the YouTube and search for Smart Industry Talks, or if you would go to the Smart Industry website, smartindustry.nl. It's war, but no one notices it. There have been several public attacks or publicly known attacks. One of them was Stuxnet in Iran, where afterwards the Iranians started to attack a Dutch company, DigiNotar, in a challenging way. It's actually all written in a book by Huub Moldekolk, and I would just advise you to read it. It's just on the ebook, €10, but it will really reset your mind on cybersecurity, because he describes quite clearly the way these military trained and later on in the public domain operating but tolerated by the national authorities, these hackers who really are out there to earn a lot of millions and even more by stealing information or using these cyber attacks. And these guys are really professional, and you'll get hurt by them once. What you really want to do is you don't want to hook up your equipment to the office network or the engineering network of your company. You really want to isolate it, such that an IT environment or an OT environment, operation technology, is not the same as an IT environment. For example, in a production line, you'll not use Wi-Fi. If you want to use Wi-Fi, use it from the office. You'll hide USB ports behind either in cabinets behind locks, or otherwise you superglue them such that no one can really use them. And all these kinds of things are necessary for these kinds of production lines. But there's more to it, and that's actually the firewall of subnetting your production line in your company network and isolating it. But first, why are we collecting so much data? This is actually the trend, that we collect more and more data, to the level at a certain moment when hardware became cheap and software became cheap and now data commerce becomes cheap. We now have all these interconnection of Internet of People, as we know it, with the web services, the mobile services and things like that. But at this moment, it's expanding to devices who are communicating on the Internet autonomously, also from your production environment, and you don't want to have all the information out in the open in the long run. But at least this Internet of Things and ultimately Internet of Services is an important trend where, as a company, you have to take care of. And in the production environment, what you do see is that the PLCs, which were there most often one switch, one motor, one input, one output, today already encounter 10 inputs to one output. And actually this collection of data evolves to that PLCs become industrial Internet of Things computers. Quite often, those will be Linux-based, a Raspberry Pi PLC. The picture you see here is a Raspberry Pi, actually running as a PLC and programmed in Python, so a new way of working, but much cheaper than existing PLC environments, but still the same kind of reliabilities on it. But by these devices, you can also start communicating as an OPC protocol. I'll explain later on. And with that protocol, you can extract a lot of data out of your equipment in a standardized way, and not in the many different proprietary solutions now. So you'll collect data in your factory quite a lot. How to store it is the next question. You don't dump it just on the computer. And that's where we introduced that digital twinning. It started with the design of products and then extended with the manufacturing information, later on the usage of a digital twin of a product. But what you can do, you can also use it for describing your production equipment and collect a lot of data on it, for example, for maintenance purposes. But these digital twins information, in this example, you see how out of the different devices, in this case a warehouse with sensors and door openers, you can collect that data, aggregate it on a higher level, and have a digital twin of the whole warehouse. The way you exchange this information is with this OPC-UA protocol. It's similar to the HTML protocol, XML is being used, and you can set up these object libraries. It's really going to be the standard in smart industry or industry 4.0 world. With it, you then have to store that digital twin information in your company network, not in the production line. So that's where we introduce these firewalls in it. But first, realize that in these production line, we will see more and more these open source systems. Really powerful tools which hardly cost anything. Python is an example of it, but Linux is also an example of it. TCP/IP protocol, now not with the HTML from the web services, but the one for equipment interfacing, OPC-Way, will all be used. And what I'll explain later on, the firewall that you need in it. So once you digitized your factory, the next thing is that you probably want to share that information in your own ecosystem. And that's where you need to have the second concept, and that's the concept of data platforms. Data platforms are actually interconnecting databases of companies, but sometimes they are on cloud, so it's really an inter-cloud connection of it, where some of the data you keep confidential, but another part of the data you could use with your customers in your customer portal. So the shareable data, you don't want to put it at one party who monopolize it in the long run, like Uber and Airbnb, but you really want to go for a commons model, as they call it, where everybody contributes, but also gets its share out of it on an equal base. And examples of it are, for example, already with GSM for the last 20 years, 30 years, but also for at this moment, the developments of the industrial data space or international data spaces, as it is now called, which will be the basis for this Gaia-X, a more European way of approaching it. And why do we need it? Well, once you start sharing it with your suppliers and sub-suppliers, and you see here that there can be a lot of sub-suppliers, you really want, and you want to share information, not only for orders to do electronically, error-free, fast, real-time, but also for distribution of design changes, and even for real-time planning on control, not only in your factory, but in the whole value chain. And especially with COVID, we have seen how important that can be. So the sharing of data in your value chain is gaining a lot of traction at this moment. But a supplier is quite often part of multiple value chains, and therefore you get these ecosystems in which you have to use these standards and use it. Now, what I want to say is that you want to extract a lot of information out of your production equipment. You want to use it in your site, your own company, digital twinning, and you want to share it, some of it, in a controlled way with your environment. And that's what I'll show in this picture. Sharing it in your environment, you use the more controlled environments with the industrial data space, where you have data sovereignty, all these aspects with it. And in your production line, what you'll do is you only let it go through your own firewall under control. So not having an equipment with a service provider somewhere in the world who has direct access to your equipment and can also see what your production is doing. No, you can only use the OPC-UA protocol. You extract it, you pass it through your firewall, and you store it in your cloud environment, your industrial data space, and then the others can see it. But they don't get access directly to your production equipment. Because if they can, with an autonomous server going just outside, and hacker can do that as well. So that's what I show here in this picture. I mentioned it already. You separate production lines in their own subnet. There's extra requirements, no EFI, no USB, but most important, with its own firewall. And that firewall is going to be locked, double locked actually. Here you see, for example, what we are using actually. This is, on one side you see the industrial PLC, the other one is the Raspberry Pis, which is exactly the same, which we use in a workshop where the users are continuously hacked when they set up their system until they really set it so far that they can keep it safe. These industrial PLCs, this is the example of the Coonbus, industrial internet things, are extremely cheap, but also extremely powerful. And that's what is interesting. Here you can get the OPC Pro protocol on it. It's pretty simple programming in Python. And this is the example, for example, what we are using then. First, they connect this PLC or this Raspberry Pi on the instruction network, just as a factory network, and they are hacked immediately. Then they start to implement it more secure, but ultimately they put it behind in their own subnet, the Raspberry Pi. And what you see here too, this is the factory network really, and this is then the network with a special firewall. And in that firewall, we do a thing which you don't do at home. At home, you keep the traffic outside blocked. But in this particular case, we not only keep the outside traffic blocked, we also block the inside traffic. So equipment from inside cannot spontaneously go outside. If they want to do it, you have to set up a contract with the supplier. But they only will use OPC-RA protocol, and it's only the OPC-RA protocol which is allowed in this particular firewall. And you see it here in the bottom. It's really the details. It's not that easy. But experimenting with it, as you can see with these kinds of devices, it hardly costs anything. These devices are about 150 euro each expensive. You can just learn playing with it. And that's what we do in the training course. Because training on cybersecurity, we think, is extremely important. What I try to mention in this particular case is that these industrial revolutions from wood and sailboats and the sawing mill in the Netherlands to the steam, the first, the second, the third, and now the fourth industrial revolution, one message gets clear. And that's the next revolution is there within one generation. So for the first time in mankind, we see the situation now that if you are 35 years old, 20 years ago, you were 15 years, you were at school, you didn't have internet. So everyone above the age of 35 years and older and who didn't go to university or higher education hardly got any digital training. And with this rapid evolution of these digital, these industrial revolutions, you know that no one will reach retirement without this school knowledge. So you have to have this lifelong learning. And that's really a best first in mankind that we have a situation like this. So finalizing, what I want to say is, guys, you'll extract a lot of data out of your production line, but you have to protect it. And you have to build up your own skills as OT environment. Skills that are resembling IT skills with particular requirements. Requirements that you create knowledge that you can block all traffic going out of your production line, only the traffic you allow to go out of it, and no traffic gets into it until unless you give premises through your firewall. Using this only this OPC-RA protocol, which is designed for something like that. And my last warning is again, it's a lot, you have to learn it yourself. You will hardly find people on the market who can do it. So learn it yourself, but it is not costly. It's only in financial terms, it's only costly in time. You have to invest in it yourself. Success with it. Thank you.